Department. Professor Benjamin Karp from the History Department and I organized this workshop as part of President Anderson's Stand Against Hate campaign. President Anderson, we are grateful for your support. Thank you. Professors Alex Vitale and Mustafa Bayoumi will be talking, and we thank them for donating their time and effort. They're excellent speakers, and we're looking forward to their talks. At the outset, I would like to emphasize that this is a nonpartisan event, and we welcome members of all political persuasions. The four of us are giving very different talks. We come from different ethnicities, ideologies, and academic backgrounds, but we're all going to make the argument that there is no place for undercover operatives at Brooklyn College, and each of us has a responsibility to do something about this growing societal menace. This is the unequivocal position we will put forward today. However, if you have the opposite position, we want to hear from you. There will be 5 or so minutes for questions and comments at the end of each talk, and I encourage you to ask questions and put forth your position in the spirit of healthy dialogue. Stay in touch with me, and when we organize the next workshop, we will find a way for you to participate. Professor Karp will be moderating this workshop, and he is the first speaker. Professor Karp is the Daniel M. Lyons Professor of American History. He has authored Rebels Rising, Cities and the American Revolution, and Defiance of the Patriots, the Boston Tea Party, and the Making of America, which won the Triennial Society of the Cincinnati Cox Book Prize in 2013. Together with Richard Brown, he co-edited Major Problems in the Era of the American Revolution, 1760 to 1791. His work has also appeared in Civil War History, Early American Studies, the William and Mary Quarterly, BBC History, Colonial Williamsburg, Wall Street Journal, and the Washington Post. So let me introduce Professor Karp and invite him to speak.
Thank you, Sandra. And we owe this entire event to Sandra. She's going to try and give me credit, but please don't listen to her, whatever she says. I want to hand this out. I'm going to get to it in a little bit, but I want to make sure that people have the text of this in front of them. I have plenty, so you'll have extra, but people may well come in late in between classes, so I want to give people an opportunity to make sure those get around. So my talk today from a scholarly perspective is not going to be tremendously original, but really I thought that there would be some merit to going back to first principles in a sense and thinking about the First Amendment in thinking about this issue of surveillance. And so that's why I'm telling this like a comic book as an origin story of the First Amendment, and taking that not from a kind of the perspective that a legal scholar might take or a political scientist, but a historian thinking about where people's heads were at in thinking about religious freedom during the founding era. So the First Amendment states, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion, or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech, or of the press, or of the right of the people peaceably to assemble, and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. Now, so that lists basically 6 freedoms, or civil liberties, that Congress can't make any laws to abridge. And we can separate these into 2 types of freedoms, right? Freedom of religion, right? Practice as you please, and you're free from any taxes or other burdensome policies that might support a state religion. So the U.S. won't proscribe any religions, and it won't prescribe an official religion. Then you have freedom of expression, right? Freedom of speech, freedom of the press, freedom of assembly, and freedom to petition the government, right? Any of which might critique or question the government in some ways, right? These are fundamental rights that we all have this vague awareness that we ought to possess. Now, as a statement of Enlightenment values, we uphold this amendment as supremely important. But what's interesting about the history of the First Amendment is, A, freedom of expression was a set of pretty old, widely understood freedoms among English-speaking people. Not necessarily widely held, but understood that these were aspirational values. So they're not necessarily an American innovation, right? We don't want to necessarily give the Americans too much credit for being like, oh, why don't we suddenly give everybody freedom of the press, right? That was something that had been argued for prior to the 1780s. And secondly, most of these freedoms aren't invoked all that often prior to the 20th century. Right? Religion and expression are mostly dealt with not by the federal government, but as state issues. And the First Amendment does not become fodder for any famous Supreme Court cases until the 20th century. They're basically uncontroversial and have relatively limited scope, even though in the past there were plenty of what we would now consider civil liberties violations, right? A few states had established religions well into the 19th century. The Sedition Act put people in jail for anti-government publications. The Southern State prevented the circulation of abolitionist literature, and so on, right? So there are plenty of things that we would now consider First Amendment issues that did not actually become First Amendment issues before the Supreme Court. That doesn't really get started for the most part until the 1940s. Even the idea of separation of church and state, right? That doesn't come from the Constitution. That comes from a letter by Thomas Jefferson. Doesn't really enter into constitutional dialogue until the 1940s. So the surveillance of Muslim students, I want to argue today, runs afoul of both of these types of First Amendment freedoms, right? Freedom of expression, right? If you look up the Hanshu Agreement of 1985, this was the result of a 1971 class action lawsuit alleging that a variety of police practices, informers, infiltration, surveillance, had a chilling effect upon the exercise of freedom of speech, assembly, and association, and it also violated the Fourth Amendment and the 14th Amendment, right? So that's the dialogue that we're used to having about the surveillance of Muslim students. But I would argue that the targeting of Muslim individuals, groups, and institutions specifically would seem to point to the other half of the First Amendment protections, that of religious freedom. Now, while the state and federal governments had often had some interest in monitoring religious groups, right, cults that are abusing children, for example, right, so we could see there being some utility to monitoring a group that calls itself religious, this has always been controversial, and enhanced surveillance technology means this issue is not going to go away anytime soon. But again, not everybody knows the origin story of our First Amendment and the Enlightenment principles that first enshrined these words into the Constitution, and so I think it would be salutary for us today to go back to them to see what lessons we can derive from them. So before we had freedom of conscience, right, what colonial America and Great Britain had was basically an established religion, mostly the Church of England, but also Congregationalism in some of the New England colonies, and then official tolerance of varying degrees for other groups who did not belong to the established religions. So tolerance is sort of a halfway house between brutal persecution, right, imprisonment, exile, corporal and capital punishment on the one hand, and total religious freedom on the other hand, right? Toleration is sort of somewhere in between. Under tolerance, maybe you can direct your taxes to a minister of your choosing, but not be able to serve in the legislative assembly, right, because you're not a member of the right religion. Plus, there might be unofficial prejudice and exclusion, of course, alongside relatively decent treatment, right? So governments can oppress people of minority religion, but obviously non-governmental institutions or people can oppress people of different religious beliefs as well. That's something important to keep in mind, that the First Amendment, right, only restricts Congress from doing something, and then the 14th Amendment will later say that the states and local governments can't do this either. So this prejudice or exclusion, whether by the state or by non-state actors, would be greater the further you get from Protestantism, because Protestantism is the dominant religion of most English-speaking people in those days, right? So Catholics or Mormons, deists or universalists, Jews, Muslims, and the traditional religions of African and Native Americans, right? You can the further you get from Orthodox Protestantism, the more prejudice you might expect to receive, right? Atheists, right, were considered totally immoral, right? If you didn't worry about the afterlife, how could you possibly behave in a moral way? That was essentially the understanding of most people. Still, by the end of the Revolutionary War, as the historian Chris Benneke writes, there was a general support for the notion that if the nation could not be exclusively Calvinist, then at least it might be Protestant, and if it could not be exclusively Protestant, then at least it might be Christian, and if it could not be exclusively Christian, then at least it might be religious, right? There was a vague notion that religion was good for keeping order, right? Because fear of the afterlife makes you behave in a moral way. But an actual religious establishment wasn't necessary and might even, and in the opinion of some founders, might even be harmful. So when people today go around saying that the United States was founded as a Christian nation or a Protestant Christian nation, it's misleading because at the time there was a range of opinion among the lawgivers who gave us the various state constitutions and the federal constitution. Some Christians thought America wasn't Christian enough and insisted on a more limited set of doctrines. Others were more liberal-minded and left the door cracked open or even wide open for even more liberality. As early as 1753, William Livingston, who would later become the governor of New Jersey, wrote, "To defend the Christian religion is one thing, but to knock a man in the head for being of a different faith is another thing." Right? So this was sort of the idea for enlightened men prior to the revolution. And this went back to older radical ideas that had been floating around about the importance of religious freedom. Right? Roger Williams, going all the way back to 1644, had written that the idea of a national religion was a terrible idea. It is the will and command of God that since the coming of his son, the Lord Jesus, a permission of the most paganish, Jewish, Turkish, or anti-Christian consciences and worships should be granted to all men in all nations and countries, and they are only to be fought against with the sword of God's Spirit, the Word of God. So in other words, like, you can't create state oppressions to prevent religions you don't like. The only way to combat it was open dialogue, essentially. And that would allow what he thought as, you know, true Christianity to kind of emerge triumphant. But he was not, he really didn't think the state had any business getting involved in that. And so Rhode Island ends up being one of the more tolerant of the most tolerant of the 13 colonies. Again, this presumes the superiority of Christianity, but still prevents Christianity from taking over or using the state because this would lead to hypocrisy. So Jefferson similarly writes in his notes on the state of Virginia, "The legitimate powers of government extend to such acts only as are injurious to others. But it does me no injury for my neighbor to say there are 20 gods or no god. It neither picks my pocket nor breaks my leg. Constraint may fix a person obstinately in his errors, but not cure them. Reason and free inquiry are the only effectual agents against error." So this is also reflecting Williams's idea, right? That we need to be able to kind of freely blunder into errors or freely come at the truth. But as long as the religion isn't interfering with people's individual rights to life, liberty, and property, the state should have nothing to say about a person's level of religiosity or the type of religion that they practice. And so the Northwest Ordinance of 1787, which laid out the rules for the settlement of the Midwestern territories, stated that no peaceable and orderly persons in these areas would ever be molested on the account of his mode of worship or religious sentiments. And it also said, "Religion, morality, and knowledge, being necessary to good government and the happiness of mankind, schools and the means of education shall be forever encouraged." So in other words, there was this vague kind of agreement that religion had both a private and public component. Conscience was individual, but morality was public. So the public does have some interest in policing morality, but not in determining what an individual's conscience might say. So in the debate over the Constitution, the only thing that the Constitution really has to say about religion is in Article 6, that there should be no religious tests for office holders. But in the debate over the Constitution, it was anti-federalists, people who were against the ratification of the Constitution, who objected that the new document did nothing to protect Protestantism and might allow a pagan, a Catholic, a Muslim, or a Jew to hold citizenship or even hold office. And the North Carolina Federalist and later Supreme Court Justice James Iredell replies, "But how is it possible to exclude any set of men without taking away that principle of religious freedom which we ourselves so warmly contend for?" Right? So most Protestants understood that you couldn't get Protestants to agree on a set of religious principles. And they also, you know, had a memory of the wars of religion, Protestant versus Catholic. So they said, you know, once you go down this slope of saying some kinds of religion are okay and some aren't, it's the Protestants who will be at each other's throats. So let's not start by excluding people who aren't Protestants, or it'll just lead to trouble for our fellow Protestants down the road. In 1789, the new president, George Washington, wish him a happy birthday today, wrote to Virginia's United Baptist Churches, "Every man conducting himself as a good citizen and being accountable to God alone for his religious opinions ought to be protected in worshiping the deity according to the dictates of his own conscience." He said this to Quakers, he said this to German Reformed, he said this to Jews. After visiting Newport in 1790, he wrote to its Jewish synagogue that the United States would no longer have a religious establishment granting toleration as an indulgence, but instead it would have a new recognition of everyone's inherent natural rights, For happily, he says, the government of the United States, which gives to bigotry no sanction, to persecution no assistance, requires only that they who live under its protection should demean themselves as good citizens. May the children of the stock of Abraham who dwell in this land continue to merit and enjoy the goodwill of the other inhabitants, while everyone shall sit in safety under his own vine and fig tree, and there shall be none to make him afraid. So for the most part, right, the United States has nothing to say. Let's even get rid of tolerance and just kind of say, live and let live, more or less. And for the most part, right, as I said, religious liberty is left to the states. So I want to turn now to the document that I've handed out, and if anyone needs one, and the one that I, in theory, have on the screen. This is the Virginia Statute of Religious Freedom, which was drafted by Thomas Jefferson in 1777, was so important to him that he lists it on his tombstone as one of his three greatest accomplishments. And it was passed into law by James Madison in the Virginia legislature in 1786. It disestablished the state power of the Anglican Church in Virginia, right, which was something that Virginia Baptists and other groups had been really angry about and thought was really unfair. And it essentially ensures religious freedom for all. And Madison gives some stirring reasons why religious liberty was necessary. During almost 15 centuries has the legal establishment of Christianity been on trial. What have been its fruits? More or less in all places, pride and indolence in the clergy, ignorance and servility in the laity, and in both superstition, bigotry, and persecution. So anywhere where you legally establish Christian, it's bad for the priests, it's bad for the worshippers, it's bad for everyone. He says that the establishment of religion is a departure from that generous policy which, offering an asylum to the persecuted and oppressed of every nation and religion, promised a luster to our country. Instead of holding forth an asylum to the persecuted, it is, in other words, religious establishment is itself a signal of persecution. It degrades from the equal rank of citizens all those whose opinions in religion do not bend to those of the legislative authority. It would have a like tendency to banish our citizens and would superadd a fresh motive to emigration out of the U.S. by revoking the liberty which they now enjoy. And this would be the same species of folly which has dishonored and depopulated flourishing kingdoms. So in other words, like religious establishment was discouraging to immigrants, and the United States wanted more immigrants, and they wanted people from persecuted religions back in the old world to come to the United States and feel that they could practice any religion that they wanted openly. And he adds to this, torrents of blood have been spilt in the old world by vain attempts of the secular arm to extinguish religious discord by proscribing all differences in religious opinion. Jefferson later explained that his intent behind the Virginia statute in his 1821 autobiography. Its protection of opinion was meant to be universal, he said, and he offered the following as proof. Someone tried to make an amendment to this statute so that a particular sentence would read that religious coercion was a departure from the plan of Jesus Christ, the holy author of our religion. But a great majority in the Virginia legislature prevented the insertion of Christ's name. So the passage now reads, and you can see this in the document, a departure from the plan of the holy author of our religion, the implication being God, right? So Jefferson explained that the Virginia Assembly meant for the statute to include, and this is a quote, under the mantle of its protection, the Jew and the Gentile, the Christian and the Mohammedan, the Hindu and infidel of every denomination. So, in other words, really, he meant this to be an extraordinarily expansive declaration of religious freedom. And there are some other astonishing passages in the preamble to the Virginia Statute, which I have here. That first paragraph is what I'm going to mostly focus on today. Almighty God hath created the mind free. In other words, if people were free, they would reason their way to truth, even religious truth. If you try to use state punishments to influence people's reasoning toward religion, it would beget habits of hypocrisy and meanness, as I said before. Why? Right? Leaders of the church and state were fallible and uninspired men. They made mistakes. They weren't necessarily pious. And so they shouldn't presume dominion over the faith of others, because this would lead to false religion, and had done so throughout history. Right? They're using the lessons of history to make their statement about religious freedom. Next. Our civil rights have no dependence on our religious opinions any more than our opinions in physics or geometry, right? So in other words, a person has a natural right to hold office just as much as his fellow citizens, whether or not he has particular religious opinions, right? We don't have tests for office based on how good your knowledge of physics or geometry are. You don't have to be smart to be president or a congressman, right? So by the same token, you don't necessarily have to be pious or shouldn't necessarily have to be pious to be a member of the state legislature. He also argues that separation of church and state, although he's not using those words here, doesn't just protect churches from state power, but also protects churches from corruption. So in other words, it makes the argument that a state religion tends only to corrupt the principles of that religion it is meant to encourage by bribing with a monopoly of worldly honors and emoluments those who will externally profess and conform to it. So in other words, if you start bestowing particular favors on Christians of a certain type, people will start going around saying, oh, I'm that type of Christian, just so that they can get some kind of plum government job, right? This is another argument against religious establishment. Though indeed, these are criminal who do not withstand such temptation, right? So in other words, if you're the type of person who's willing to profess a certain type of Christianity just to get a job, yet neither are those innocent who lay the bait in their way. So in other words, if you pass a law saying that only certain kinds of Christian can hold office, you're just as guilty as the type of person who would hypocritically take that office by falsely professing a certain type of Christianity. The document goes on to say that it's a dangerous fallacy to restrain religious ideas on supposition of their ill tendency, right? So in other words, just because you think an idea might be bad doesn't mean you can suppress it. And once you make a magistrate the judge of people's religious beliefs, that magistrate will start enforcing laws according to his own code of beliefs, which then destroys all religious liberty, right? So again, these kind of slippery slope arguments of what might happen if you had a religious establishment. And then it begins to conclude, truth is great and will prevail if left to herself, and also that truth has nothing to fear from the conflict with error unless human beings get rid of free argument and debate. So as long as you can freely contradict bad ideas, these ideas won't be that dangerous. And that brings us back to the other half of the First Amendment, which is the doctrine of free expression of various kinds. So to conclude, for the most part, what I've laid out are the ideals of elite white men who wanted to establish a kind of pluralist consensus that everyone from George Washington to George W. Bush might support in theory. Founders asserted that pluralism was a settled fact, but that it was also necessary in order to guarantee religious liberty. And Madison even says that in Federalist 51 that the security of people's rights lay in a multiplicity of sects. Right, that what made America work was the fact that no one could agree on religion, and you had a lot of different types of religious beliefs, created an umbrella of protection for everyone's religious freedom. Right, that there is no silent majority who gets to tell everyone else what to do. But those ideals, like many other things about the new United States, were described at the time as an experiment, and they have never been ideals with 100% support in America as we know. Indeed, Virginia was an exception among the state constitutions. Most of the rest of them did require professions of Christianity or Protestant Christianity in some way. As we know, conservative Christians in the United States have taken up the mantle of religious liberty to allow private companies to restrict access to birth control or discriminate against gay and transgender people. And plenty of people find a sort of fearful solace in their prejudices against religions that are different from them. One of the things that Federalists said to anti-federalists who were worried, like, oh, this means that you could technically elect a Muslim to a president or something like that, they would say, first of all, what are the odds of that, right? If somebody really has such repugnant beliefs that they're really going to get the votes of a majority of people. And then they kind of said, well, even if they were to win, right, that would mean that they had so conformed to our good ideas about what was valuable that they deserved to win. But with the implication that, like, look, we're going to allow this in theory, but given the American electorate, what are the odds, right? And so, but again, they still enshrined those freedoms in some of our founding document. So I would argue that in this debate over the surveillance of Muslim students, we can use the founders to hit back. The United States really didn't intend to grant religious liberty to Christians only, because they knew that once they did, Christians would begin fighting among themselves over which brand of Christianity. And you could foresee Christians today having those same kind of fights if they were ever left alone and granted religious freedom only to Christians. Right? Who knows whether our opponents in this debate can be made to have this foresight, but it remains the case that the legal, constitutional, and ideological underpinnings of religious liberty have a profound power in this country, and they remain a basis for radical appeals to equality, to freedom of conscience and expression, and to freedom from oppression and surveillance. Thank you, everyone. So I'm going to introduce the next speaker. I'm going to do very brief introductions. So this is Mustafa Bayoumi, who has two books on how what Muslim American life looks like in a post 9/11 world. He's written for public audiences in a wide variety of publications, which I urge you to seek out. And you can give the title of your talk yourself. So welcome.
Hello. Everyone hear me okay? Well, thank you, Benjamin, for that introduction, and also to Sandra and to President Anderson for putting all of this together and the support. I think this is actually a very, very crucial discussion to have. And it's a, you know, this is an academic institution. We talk about all kinds of academic problems. However, the question of surveillance by the New York City Police Department on this campus is not an academic question. It is an actual question. It's a real question. It's a real event that happened. And it's something that I think that is very important to understanding the health of our students, but also the health of this institution. And so I think it's something that we have to grapple with very seriously and consider very deliberately as to what kinds of things that unwarranted surveillance bring. Of course, I'm sure most people here already know what I'm talking about, but I'm going to repeat what you already know, because I think it's very useful that we have a sense about what the parameters are here. And some of you may not even know. And I'm also, today, in my talk, I'm actually going to be speaking a lot from testimony that was given almost exactly to the day, a year ago. About a year ago, I organized a panel here at the college about the NYPD surveillance, in which I invited a journalist who had written about it. I invited Ramzi Al-Qasim from CUNY Clear, and two students, one former student and one current student at the time, Muslim students who knew about the surveillance, in fact, who had been affected by the surveillance on the campus. And I thought that the events of that night were so incredible that I'm going to read a lot about from that night itself, actually. Both of those students have since graduated from the college, but their words will still resonate. In this, what began as a confirmation, really, for Muslim communities, especially in the New York City area, was the 2011 series that was reported on by the Associated Press, that the NYPD had a large and a massive spying operation against the daily lives of Muslim Americans and Muslims in the tri-state area. In fact, they reached beyond the borders even of New York City. And they were, not only were they engaged in these efforts, to my mind, unconstitutionally, and in fact, with the help of people who had been borrowed from the Central Intelligence Agency. So there's a synergy there between different kinds of intelligence agencies, but also the level of surveillance that they were doing was based primarily on monitoring the activities of very ordinary life. So they were monitoring everything from who would go to certain mosques, what cafes people were eating at, where people went to get their hair cut, all of this sort of stuff, completely and far away from any kind of directed intelligence towards any specific threat, right? It was just the kind of tactics that we have seen in the past from groups like the Stasi in East Germany, this sort of sense of monitoring every level of ordinary life. And in fact, what it does is it ends up criminalizing every level of ordinary life. And one way of responding to it, once this came out, I think this is always important, is to respond as much as you can with humor. I think humor can actually be a great deflator of power. So, for example, Gawker, may Gawker rest in peace, Gawker had this great little page up, because once the documents came out from the NYPD that the Associated Press had released them, Gawker did like Yelp reviews of all of the different Muslim restaurants that the NYPD had gone to, and they were just using the NYPD commentary about the Yelp reviews. It was actually really funny. But it just also illustrated how ridiculous the whole thing was. In fact, it was so ridiculous that the captains, you know, they would send these plainclothes police officers to all of these different locations just to monitor who was eating what and what television was on, what television channel was on in the cafe, etc., right? And it was considered suspicious if Al Jazeera was on the TV, and it was also considered suspicious if Al Jazeera was not on TV. Different reports. I'm not kidding you. And then they would also found, one of the other things that they found was that they had to fill out a very bureaucratic form about where they were going, the police officers did. And so there was multiple reports that the police officers were stopping, were surveilling this one bakery in Brooklyn, right? And at one point, one of the superior officers says, "Enough with this bakery. Why is everyone going to this bakery and surveilling this bakery?" And then the police officers had to admit that there was always at the end of the day, too, because they were just stopping there to actually buy the food because they thought the food was so delicious. And then that was on the dime of the NYPD. Right? I cannot make this up. So this is actually in the documentation. For Muslim communities, I'll tell you, in New York City, this was not a... we were not blown away by this report. It was actually a confirmation rather than a revelation. Muslim communities had suspected that these kinds of things were going on all along. I'll tell you, I started writing my book, How Does It Feel to Be a Problem, probably around 2005, 2006, and I was spending a lot of time with different young Arab Americans, Muslim Americans around the borough of Brooklyn, and they were telling me all kinds of stories back then. This is 2011 is when the AP story came out. They were telling me stories about people who were just hanging out in the cafes with no visible means of support and all day long and just like eavesdropping and listening and like asking all these kinds of weird questions, or they would report to me that they were getting followed bizarrely on the streets by certain cars, and they were suspicious about all of this. And there are many other cases of even documented cases of people who then had prosecutions brought up against them, and then it was clear that there had been informants and spies within the midst of the Muslim communities therein. So this was not really a surprise for Muslim communities. But I think, you know, when the report came out in 2011, when the report started coming out in 2011, first thing they did, the NYPD said, this is completely not true. The AP has this great imagination. And then the AP then released all the documents to the public, a bunch of the documents to the public to show that this is actually true. And the New York City Police Department just showed that it freely lies to its public. After that, a series of reports came out. And then another investigative reporter, Lynn Levitt, who actually has a historic connection to Brooklyn College, also had a source within the New York City Police Department and started also writing some reports about the surveillance. And one of the things that came out from both reports was that, in fact, there had also been surveillance on college campuses, CUNY campuses in particular. And certain CUNY campuses were considered to be of high interest, one of which was Brooklyn College. And even in one of the documents, it said that the NYPD was particularly interested in a lecturer of Middle Eastern descent on Brooklyn College's campus. That made me think. There aren't that many lecturers of Middle Eastern descent on Brooklyn College's campus. So, in fact, I've seriously considered whether it was myself. And in fact, the New York Times called me to ask me if they thought it was me. The Associated Press called me to ask me if I thought it was me. I don't think it was me, actually, according to someone else that was knowledgeable about these things. But it certainly got me thinking. And it certainly got me thinking about the degrees to which, you know, why would they waste their time on me? I mean, I'm as dangerous as an academic, which is not very dangerous. And the warrantlessness of this surveillance, of course, is deeply troubling. So that came out in 2011. And then by the time we get to October of 2015, in October of 2015, we find out that there's been a continuation of the surveillance on this campus. So there was another example of a woman who went by the name of Mel, M-E-L, right, who had been on CUNY's campus, on Brooklyn College's campus, I should say, from 2011 to 2015. Okay, and she had been working, she had been befriended, she came to befriend the Muslim students here on the campus, and she was, as it turns out, an undercover New York City police officer. She was not an informant. We've since learned, just like we now know things like emoluments clauses and things like that, we've since learned how to differentiate between, say, undercovers versus informants, rakers versus prowlers, to use NYPD terminology. So a raker would be somebody who is working with the NYPD and is looking for something specific. Somebody who goes in, and the expression comes from raking the coals, going into Muslim communities and trying to find everything that's there. And crawlers go into Muslim communities and try to recruit informants. Right? And so undercovers actually work for the NYPD, and informants usually do. Informants do not. Usually they might have a low-level crime that they have performed, and then the NYPD offers them some kind of way of getting out of it, that they will then spy on their own communities. This is, we have several examples of that. One of which was another CUNY student from another campus. He actually, when these AP reports came out, he came forward to the AP and showed them all of his information. Anyway, going back to Mel. So let me read you from the article that was exposing what Mel, what Mel's activities were. At first, Mel seemed warm and friendly, if a bit eager, the article writes. This is from Aviva Stahl, the journalist. She was very nice, very charming, said Shireen. So Aviva had interviewed a bunch of the students on campus and then used pseudonyms for the students, so these are not actual names either. I should note that the way that they found out that Mel was an undercover police officer was in a separate filing. There were two young women from Queens who were arrested on some terrorism prosecution. And when that arrest became public, it became Mel's face was part of that arrest. She had also been involved in that case. So when her face was then on the media, the students here immediately recognized her. And they're like, oh, now we know. Now we know for sure. And then they felt this great betrayal. So then they, of course, then they started to think, well, what did we tell her? Who was she? And so at that point then, this became a topic of conversation among many people here on campus. And then not long after, Aviva Stahl, who's a very enterprising journalist, wrote this article for Gothamist. So she writes, at first, Mel seemed warm and friendly, if a bit eager. She was very nice, very charming, said Shireen, who studied psychology at Brooklyn College and now works as a psychotherapist. She wanted to do everything with us, Mel told the Islamic Student Organization, the ISO's women, that she was a recent Rutgers College graduate who had grown up in Queens. She said that she was of Turkish descent and had been born into a Muslim but non-practicing family. The women active in Brooklyn College's Islamic Society were diverse. They majored in women's studies, psychology, pre-med, and political science, hung out with friends, crushed on boys, and nurtured their newfound political consciousness. They were coming of age in a city scarred by 9/11, and although their Muslim identity did not define them, it shaped their everyday lives. But they knew their behavior was being scrutinized by the authorities. After 9/11, both the NYPD and the FBI revamped their approach to terrorism investigations and began operating under a policy of preventive prosecution. In an internal document from 2007, the NYPD identified particular indicators of radicalization, which include things like wearing traditional clothing, giving up drinking or smoking, and becoming involved in social activism. Wow, that's crazy. In the NYPD's model of measuring threats, which has since been broadly criticized, young people were a key target. Shireen, then 25, was a close friend, and a close friend, Faiza, were responsible for introducing new converts like Mel to the basic tenets of Islam. One day in early April 2011, Mel asked Faiza to meet her on campus. Faiza told me afterward that Mel asked her some strange questions, like, what is all this about jihad, Shireen recalled, and asking about people who do suicide bombing. For Shireen and Faiza, Mel's questions were a red flag. They suspected she was digging for information on the political beliefs of ISO members, possibly even pressing them to make incriminating statements. So Mel shows up around 2011. She was always around. She had no visible means of support. She wasn't a student, as far as I understand. She was just sort of hanging out on campus and going to different clubs and events and that sort of thing. When the AP reports then come out, the students start to get very worried. And they think, well, maybe something seems suspicious about her. So they actually went to CUNY Clear. And they asked CUNY Clear, what should we do? We think that there's a possibility that somebody on our campus is an undercover police officer. And then CUNY Clear said, well, unless you have any clear evidence, then we're not sure what you can do. So they then started to Google Mel and her name, looked everywhere for her, and they actually found not a shred of evidence, not even her name, anything popped up on Google, which these days, that's what's suspicious, frankly, right? In the meantime, Mel, different students come in over the years as well. Students come in, students leave. Mel befriends all kinds of students. She goes to student events. She goes to bridal showers. She attends a wedding. In 2014 and fall of 2015, so this is pretty recent history at this point, there's a group on campus called Unity, which was a Students of Color organizing group. And Mel went to those meetings as well. That group, the Unity group, although there were students from the, there were Muslim students in that group that had very little to do, if anything, with Islam. And then in April of 2015, that's when there's the arrest in Queens, when Mel's face becomes visible to the larger public as identifiable with the NYPD, and that's when that changes. So the revelation that we had confirmation, right? Because that's the important part. That we had confirmation that there was an undercover NYPD officer who was monitoring the what should be the free and protected activities of students on campus. Not, mind you, because these students were themselves engaged in any specific thing. It was just their general participation in the groups. The revelation itself was traumatic on multiple levels. For one thing, it's corrosive to trust between people, right? Between students. You don't know who works for the NYPD. You don't know what the motivations are with your friendships between different people here. Two, it's corrosive to one's own sense of self and security and willingness to trust others. Sometimes you suspect that other people might think that you yourself are an informant. Three, since we know that she was here, we don't know how many others there are. Four, and what if what I say, the students would often say, and I think this is true also for faculty, is transcribed, taken out of context, so our freedom of thought, freedom of expression, and in fact our academic freedom then is also at threat. So I think that it's important to understand that, sort of baseless, warrantless surveillance on campus is not just a First Amendment, I see it as not just a First Amendment violation, but I also see it as a fundamental violation of academic freedom. So in that spirit, let me read you from what the two students from last year's panel said, if you don't mind. Bear your indulgence. So this is one of the students said this. So oftentimes we're told that if you're not doing anything wrong, there shouldn't be anything to fear. But despite not doing anything wrong, despite living a very straight, clear, clean life, there's this fear that people will take what you say out of context. As far as academic freedom, within a classroom environment, you're expected to go out of your comfort zone. It may be far-fetched. You might just be discussing controversial ideas, and you'll be talking about things that are problematic. But when you go into a classroom environment, or when you're talking to your peers or your professors, and then you have this fear that you cannot actually discuss certain ideas to the point where you're monitoring what you're allowing yourself to think, it's such a stunting, debilitating feeling to experience that you can't, as a Muslim, because of your Muslimness, because of your particular political views or ideas or things that you are interested in, may not even be solidified views that you actually adhere to, but because of those particular things, you become a target for people to start spying on you. Because that college or university space kind of serving as a microcosm for society, then what does that then do when we come out of this space and we start interacting with other people? For me personally, it had such a scarring effect for my interactions with other individuals, for me to feel that I'm surrounded by informants or undercovers, or that others are suspecting me of that. I begin selecting then who I will speak to, who I will allow myself to be around, and that, in so many ways, stunts all these opportunities that I could otherwise have. And then another student. The first student had much direct contact with Mel. The other student was a little bit younger. She had less. Both have, like I said, graduated now. She says, I wasn't particularly involved with the Islamic Student Organization, the ISO. I would go to some events, but my involvement wasn't that deep. So for me, Mel wasn't someone I knew well enough beforehand to suspect. But she was someone that upon seeing a picture of her, I was like, oh my God, I've interacted with this woman before. And where those interactions were in Unity meetings. Unity was basically kind of an informal group that was comprised of Black, Latino, and Muslim students, where we would talk about creating events, making sure our schedules and matched up with our calendar events, and it wasn't particularly remarkable in any way. But she was at three of those meetings throughout 2014. So in the spring and in the fall of 2014, and I just think about how under, oh, sorry, so in the spring and in the fall of, I've lost my line. And I just think how unremarkable those meetings were and why they would warrant any surveillance. And it's because, well, for me, the only reason could possibly be because that room of students is shades of brown and black. And just by virtue of that, it warrants being surveilled and warrants suspicion. And because for me, it felt like this is what people who are criminalized in this country looks like. And that's what that confirmed for me when I found out that this woman who had been at our meetings was an undercover cop. She continues to describe how she'd had other examples of encounters with surveillance, including with her social media account postings showing up in random places. And then she says, it was very clear that my internet, my social media could never really be private, but I couldn't use it as a place to interact with friends, family, colleagues, or post personal things. But I had to make peace with that because at the very least, I could control that. And how Mel was different from this was that I couldn't really control it. She came in a place that I thought was a safe space. I thought that these places where I was talking with friends, with peers, was a safe space. And to have that bubble also burst really, really confirmed my feelings growing up, that I was unwelcome here. And that is a feeling that a lot of Muslims that I know also have, just this feeling of unwelcomeness. But now it didn't have to do just with slurs in the street or someone telling me to go back to your country and then I could joke about it and be like, you know, I was born at Lutheran Medical Center. Do you want me to go live there? That I could joke about. This wasn't just about isolated incidents then. It was that the state viewed me as a criminal, not for any reason besides how I look or my name or my religious background. Yeah, I think others have, in my years here of teaching at Brooklyn College too, I mean, I've had multiple students come talk to me, actually. Often, they don't want anything to follow up on it. But, you know, they've also had encounters with various levels of surveillance, usually off campus, whether it be with the NYPD or with the FBI. And so there's also a level of, I think, I'm trying to understand what the relationship would be with freedom of expression and academic freedom when you have these levels of surveillance, not just on campus, but also for our student body when they're off campus at the same time. Now, as we know, Benjamin brought up the Hantru case and the Hantru guidelines, and the what has happened since the NYPD surveillance has become public was that there were several cases that were filed against the New York City Police Department for this reason, one of which was an attempt to try to rein in the Hanshu guidelines, which had been weakened after 2011. This is a consent decree that was trying to tell the police department that they should have, in fact, reasonable suspicion in order to investigate anybody, and they can't just engage in this kind of monitoring, blanket monitoring. And other groups, of course, have gone through this in the past. But that, to me, is no excuse. That's actually a reason why we should not be repeating our history rather than saying that since it's happened in the past, then it's not then it's something that we should expect. And then with one of the cases, with the same judge who actually had ruled on the Hanshu guidelines, Judge Haight, Jr., he, for people who don't know, then the NYPD and the plaintiffs in that case had come to a settlement, and that they thought that that settlement would somehow mitigate some of the more excesses of the surveillance strategies that the NYPD had been involved in. And then last October, in a surprise, really, I think, to a lot of people, the judge declined the settlement. He refused the settlement. And he said that the settlement did not go far enough to rein in the NYPD. Right? And he said that the NYPD had shown, quote, a systematic inclination to ignore the rules protecting free speech and religion. It's quite remarkable. The proposed role and powers of the civilian representative, he wrote, do not furnish sufficient protection for potential violations of the constitutional rights of those law-abiding Muslims and believers in Islam who live, move, and have their being in this city, he said. So that's where we are now in terms of the litigation. And I don't know what's going to happen now also with this change of administration that we have in this country and where that's going to move the direction of these issues as well. I think certainly what we do understand is that surveillance is not always lawful, and surveillance is also not harmless. I think we can see the harms from the surveillance that I hope you can hear it in the voices that I was reading to you. One more example would be even at Hunter College's Muslim Student Association, they even have a sign. I'm not sure if it's still there, but I've seen the sign, and others have commented on this. There's even a sign there that says, please refrain from political conversations in the MSA. It's a university, which is, of course, the place where you're supposed to have these kinds of conversations. So I think that it's really a fundamental point to understand the relationship and the role, actually, that Muslim Americans and civil rights are sharing right now. And it's kind of, you know, objectively, academically, it's fascinating for me to think about this. Not only in the terms of the surveillance issue that we're talking about today, but even also in terms of, say, the travel ban that Mr. Trump tried to roll out maybe 4 weeks ago now. Because I don't know how many of you followed, I'm sure everybody knows what I'm talking about, right? The Muslim ban that he was, yeah. But I don't know how closely people were following the legal challenges to the Muslim ban. But in fact, in Washington, where the judge ruled for the temporary restraining order on the ban, the reason why he put the temporary restraining order on the ban, one of the most fundamental reasons why, was that there was harm to universities by this Muslim ban. There was, because Muslim students who had already been admitted to the university would not be allowed to continue their studies. And that would be harm to the public universities of the state of Washington. Right? So there's the role of the public university institution is guaranteeing, is contested, and is the place where the fight for our civil liberties is currently happening in this country. And we are in the center of it here at Brooklyn College. We have been for many years, and we may even still be today, and we don't know. So I think, you know, that's why these meetings like today are so fundamentally important, that we can actually talk about this and try to also develop strategies about what to do next. And I think one of the things that we should be also considering is, of course, pressing our university administrators and our elected officials, right, that this is just not okay. We need guidelines. We need to understand exactly when the NYPD is on campus, when they are not on campus, when they are allowed to be on campus, when they are not allowed to be on campus. We need to know that that in a city like New York City, that the police department cannot and will not and should not be above the law.
Thank you. I'm sorry, I misunderstood what Sandra had said before, which was that she wanted us to allow 5 minutes of questions after each of the speakers.
Well, so, if there are any questions.
Yeah, if there are any questions, I would want people to have an opportunity to ask either Professor Bayoumi or myself about our remarks. We're about halfway through the program right now, and so it might be nice to kind of just have a little bit of open dialogue and then go on to our next speaker. Or if people have no questions, we can just keep going through. So let's allow at least a little time for questions. Yes, please.
Okay.
So I was, this is my second semester of Brooklyn College. I'm from Brooklyn. And I have a question. What about the safety of people in Brooklyn who are, so every time that we see an attack, there's always a common denominator with the attack.
What's
First
the
all,
common denominator?
I'm very nervous right now, so whatever. But every time there's an attack on American soil, there's always a common denominator, which is that it's radical Islam. And so what about the safety of our country, and what about the majority of Muslims that are not radical, that want the radical Muslims to stop doing what they're doing so they're not stigmatized by them?
Right. Yeah. No, I understand the question, but I think I would question the question. I would question some of the premises of the question, because if you look at the number of attacks, for example, you're saying that every time there's an attack in the United States, there's a common denominator. But in fact, the number of attacks, say by right-wing white male extremists, is much, much higher than it is by Muslim extremists in this country, by numbers of matters of degree. And yet, we focus so exclusively, and our media focuses so much on the Muslim extremist, because it's also very, I think it's part of our culture, to our American media culture, to think about violence as coming somehow from the outside rather than being part of our own. The problem is not that there is a state security trying to guarantee safety. The problem is that they're trampling on the rights of everybody when there's no even indication that they're looking at a probable cause. In fact, I think that makes us less safe rather than more safe. And I think that's, once these things come out, for example, people start to feel nervous, angry, upset with various intelligence and policing agencies in the country. That's certainly not good for safety. You should only be investigating things where there's actually a cause to investigate them, rather than blanket surveillance of people on the basis of their group characteristics, it seems to me. And I think that that's a fundamental guarantee. That's part of the American system. And so if we don't participate in that guarantee, then we're not only sort of chipping away at the foundations of American society, but I actually think that we're making ourselves less safe.
Well, what about all that's what's preached at such a young age to kids, not only in America, Muslims all over the world, who teach their kids, to America, what about that?
I don't think
you don't think that happens?
Not very, it's not to the same degree that you see it in the media.
I'm not talking about the media at all. I'm talking about death being preached, and death to America, and hate of America being preached to kids at a very small age. I grew up in a community that was extremely racist against everybody who lived around. I grew up in Brooklyn, so I grew up in a community that was extremely racist and brought me up racist, that people who didn't look like me are different, and I got over that, and I left my community, and I'm not part of that community anymore, but I still, if there's always a common denominator, and they're teaching their kids hate from a young age, just like people in my community, my age right now, we're the same age, we're both women who live in Brooklyn, and they have a totally different and look on other people than I do. It happens in all communities of all types, and to say that it doesn't happen in the Muslim community, it happens. There's hate being preached.
There's as much hate, I suppose you could say, being preached in the Muslim community as there is in any other community. I'm completely willing to accept that.
I mean, Jefferson would have argued that you can't do anything about the fact that some people are brought up ignorant, right? But one of the other accomplishments that he lists on his tombstone is founding the University of Virginia, right, as a public university, right? And it goes back to the role that public higher education can play, right, is that it does give an opportunity to kind of overcome whatever childhood prejudices they might have started out with, and, you know, kind of give them an opportunity to begin thinking about this stuff a little bit more deeply, taking other people's perspectives, etc.
I just want to say one more thing. Okay. The argument that you brought up is that the MOTD is doing mass surveillance on one kind or like a certain group of people.
Correct.
And you're saying that the majority of these people are irrelevant to what they're looking for.
Correct.
There's nothing here. But in the past, you said you don't want you, and you also mentioned that about repeating history.
Right.
So, in history, we've seen countries and dictators and kings have killed out, wiped out hundreds of millions of people, and the peaceful majority were irrelevant to the situation going on. For example, Hitler was able to kill as many people as he did, and the peaceful majority of Germany were irrelevant to the situation. And the same goes with Stalin. He killed 20 million people almost, or something like that, and the peaceful majority of Russia were irrelevant to the situation. 9/11, there's 2.something million Americans in the United States, and it takes 19. In America, 2001, the 9/11.
Okay, yeah.
There's about 2 million Muslims in America then, or maybe even more, and it took 19 hijackers. So the peaceful majority were irrelevant to the situation. You can't nitpick 19 people out of 2.3 million. The peaceful majority were irrelevant to the situation. It only takes a certain amount of radicals to destabilize, whether it was Hitler, whether it was Stalin, whether it was Japan when they did their massacre, when they killed people. It only takes a certain amount of people to create havoc.
You know, in the United States, there's a really important principle that I think we need to remember. Which is guilt is an individual concept.
Guilt?
It's not guilt. Yeah, you are responsible for your individual actions. I am not responsible for the actions of every Muslim all over the world.
100% not.
That's right. Yes.
I believe that.
Okay.
So why is there a problem when if you condemn what's going on?
Right.
Then why don't you want our country to be safe?
Of course I do. I'm saying there's not
that are radicalized not to be on a watch to be watched and to be monitored.
Say that again. Do I not want to be watched and monitored? I do not want to be watched and monitored.
Not you, but people who have reason.
That's the point, right there.
We've seen it before that we don't know who.
Okay, I think we're kind of going around in circles now, right? So I think we have some other questions.
We have a question from Facebook from the college's account. Roger asks, what are some signs that students who protest at the school in a peaceful manner or otherwise look for if they feel they have an undercover operative in their groups?
What are the signs they should look for? Well, I don't have a to-do list.
How to identify an undercover operative.
That's a little more my...
Yeah, that may be something that'll be addressed in one of the other...
Maybe you could ask that again after I speak.
Excellent, thank you.
You were saying that we have to develop some strategies to do something for the current situation.
Right, yes.
What are the strategies?
Well, that's what I'm hoping we can develop here today. I mean, I think one of the things that we need to do is actually be able to hold, you know, CUNY accountable for that, right? Because the administration, we had a different administration back then, both at the chancellor level and at the college level, but they spoke out very mildly against the, if at all, against the surveillance. And and I think that it's important. CUNY is one of the city agencies and a state agency, and so they should be able to speak out against the actions of another agency. And in fact, you know, one of the things that the NYPD surveillance revealed was that they were also, you know, as I said, they had gone beyond the borders of New York City, and they were following students on these whitewater rafting trips, and they had gone into different, they were at Rutgers, and they were at, I think it was Princeton, I forget if it was Princeton or Yale, but there were students at one of those colleges were also impacted by this. And then when the revelation came out, immediately the president of whatever, either it was Princeton
Yale.
Or Yale.
It was Yale?
Yeah. Issued a statement that said that this is unconscionable and this is unconstitutional. And we need that kind of leadership, I think, from CUNY as well.
No, because it's shocking. I didn't know that there was a surveillance before going on. But what if it's happening right now? So, like, what should we do? Like, if I met somebody, like, the campus, like, who's asking me this kind of jihad questions,
right?
Something like that. So what should I say?
I think one of the things to do is also get in touch. If you suspect those sorts of things, you should get in touch with people at CUNY Clear. CUNY Clear is a very good program. It's part of the CUNY system. It comes out of the CUNY Law School. Okay. And they have, it's a clinic, it's a legal clinic that does work on these kinds of issues.
Know your rights, it does work. Whole range of issues around this. How to respond, how to identify undercover folks.
Absolutely, yeah. You know, because the most important thing is that we don't actually start, you know, being afraid of each other. We can't let that happen.
Like, what if I don't want to answer? Then I might be more like suspicious, like why he doesn't want to answer. Because I don't know a lot about these things. Like, it's a very a broad issue.
At the end of the all the talks, there'll be a little bit more discussion on strategy.
All right, yeah, I do want to make sure we keep the program moving forward and to leave more time for discussion at the end. So I'll introduce Professor Alex Vitale, who is a specialist in the sociology department on urban politics, policing, social movements, et cetera, and who will be directing his remarks on predictive policing. All right, thank you.
Thanks for Sandra for putting this together, and for folks for coming, for the president for supporting it. So I'm going to get into some of the politics of policing issues that are raised by all this, and sort of a way to think about where we are in this sort of rethinking handshoe moment, Trump moment, etc. So the old policing of this kind of stuff could be thought of under a rubric of political policing. This goes back to the policing of communist movements, red squads, and this is policing that's typically done in partnership with local police and federal police, although most of the lift is actually typically done by local police, with the feds playing more of a clearinghouse role. So this will be relevant later. So, how is political policing changing in relationship to other kinds of policing? Because there are a lot of big innovations going on in policing. And we're going to hear a little bit from Sandra in a minute about network technology and how that might be influencing this. This is central. So the NYPD very proudly claims to be engaging in what we call precision policing, which is a form of predictive policing. And this is really a transition away from the kind of stop and frisk Operation Impact policing that used to exist. In that system, high crime neighborhoods were treated to widespread indiscriminate policing, in a sense, so that instead of targeting individuals based on probable cause or reasonable suspicion, if there was a shooting in an area, every young person, especially if they were male, would be stopped, would be searched, would be questioned, would be challenged, would be harassed. It was widespread. And this produced a lot of resentment because, of course, the vast majority of these young men were not engaged in any wrongdoing. They were stopping the children of politicians. They were stopping politicians. They were stopping religious leaders and their children. You know, kids who were not up to any good, who were not up to no good, were being constantly harassed. And so now the police department says, we've pulled back on that. We're not doing 600,000 stops a year. We're doing 20,000 stops a year, let's say. And instead, we're trying to identify who the real problems are. You can already see a potential progressive analogy with this kind of political policing. We're not going to surveil everyone. We're going to target our surveillance. But we'll think a little bit more deeply about this in a second. So under predictive policing or precision policing, there's an extensive use of technology, databases, algorithms to try to identify both individuals and places that may be associated with future crime committing. Now, part of this is kind of self-evident. If there are a lot of burglaries in an area, we should, you know, assign some undercover operatives, have more of a uniform presence. But this technology has moved much further along. Rather than just responding to a past pattern, they're trying to anticipate future patterns. They might be, for instance, combining a real-time map of burglary activity and overlaying on that the addresses of known past burglars, overlaying on that where the low-income housing is versus the higher-income house, lay that over, and that's going to give you areas that are at higher risk. And there are cities now in the U.S. where officers are given predictive printouts for their area saying things like, there is a 10% elevated risk of car break-ins in this parking garage between the hours of 3 and 5 p.m. The implication being you should be patrolling in that area during that time period. And even more so, you should be stopping people, surveilling people in that parking garage who don't appear to be there for a proper purpose. And even more so, perhaps the standard for stopping them is elevated by the fact that we have this risk algorithm. So normally for a stop, question, and frisk, a so-called Terry stop, there must be reasonable suspicion. It can't just be a hunch. It can't just be because you're in a particular place and you fit some vague profile. There has to be something that the officer can articulate about you in that moment that warrants they're stopping you and questioning you and potentially patting you down. Not a real search, just a pat down. Police now are looking to this predictive technology to be part of the basis for the reasonable suspicion. In essence, an undermining of the Fourth Amendment. We'll get back to that. Another way that this new technology is shaping policing is in the enforcement against violent youth gangs, which is really the department's language. Crews, gangs, who they associate with most of the serious remaining residue of serious violence in the city, shootings, stabbings. And it is true that that kind of criminal activity is heavily concentrated in a fairly small number of geographic areas that are very low income, geographically isolated, and mostly minority, and a lot of it around public housing. And so the police department's precision thinking is that we know where the problem is, we know the demographics of the young people who are producing the problem, so we need to target our efforts. How do we do that? Well, we do a couple of things. We do individualized risk assessments of young people. We look at past arrests. Were they involved in foster care? Have they been kicked out of school a certain number of times? Have they been shot, a friend of theirs shot, a family members of theirs shot? We don't know exactly what's in these algorithms. They're private, proprietary, and often tied to for-profit companies. But we have some idea of what goes into them. And that produces a kind of hot sheet. In Chicago, they're using these, in Los Angeles, and in New York. they have lists of young people that they feel are at high risk of both shooting and being shot, and they're doing a targeted program called Focus Deterrence, which is that they bring these young people in. Many of them are on probation and parole, so they're subject to being compelled to come to a meeting at which an array of city officials from the district attorney's office, probation, parole, police department, mayor's office, sit them down in a room like this and tell them that they're being watched, that if the violence doesn't stop, they're going to be targeted for extra prosecution, for enhanced charges. They're going to basically throw the book at them. This is called pulling levers. They're going to pull every lever they can if the violence doesn't stop. And it's not just if they commit the violence, if anyone in the neighborhood commits the violence, they're going to pay for it. Because the assumption is that these young people are all networked, are all connected together. How do they know this? By relying on social media and past arrest records. In public housing in New York City, if you're a young man who's got to go to school every day, who's got to go to the playground, go to the corner store, you cannot be a social island. These are heavily networked places. You have got to learn to get along with people, to be associated with people, or you can't get to school safely. You can't get to the corner store safely. So everyone in these communities is networked. And also for positive reasons, for social support, I need some help with something, the moms are networked for social support, I need a little childcare help, can you help, right? These poor, isolated neighborhoods have much denser social networks than middle class communities do. Their networks are more diffuse, spread out, diverse in nature. You've got work networks, friends, people you went to college with. You may have more Facebook followers than a kid in this neighborhood, but the networks aren't dense in the same way, and they're not geographically linked in the same way. So what the city is doing is that in addition to these individualized meetings, they're engaged in broad-ranging conspiracy prosecutions in which up to over 100 people will be arrested and charged with murder because there was a murder that someone committed, maybe one or two people, but everyone in that community is networked and they're claiming that it's a criminal enterprise. Why? Well, because I'm Facebook friends with the person who did the murder, and maybe we both got arrested smoking marijuana in the pot, the marijuana in the park 5 years ago, therefore there's a criminal predicate to our relationship. Now we're part of a criminal enterprise. So they're using state conspiracy charges and federal RICO statutes. These were the conspiracy statutes developed to go after the mob that basically allow prosecutors to say if there's any kind of network connection, we believe you were part of a criminal enterprise, that's all the evidence we need. The threshold of the evidence is incredibly low. Okay, all of this is now at the center of modern policing. These are the cutting edge tools that are being used to try to get a handle on what's going on in Baltimore, what's going on in Chicago, and to keep crime going down in New York. And I spent almost all of last week at police headquarters talking with the top command staff going to come. They believe this is the reason that shootings are down, is these wide-ranging conspiracy cases and the intensive targeting of these young people. So what does this have to do with having police on campus? With political policing, we think, oh, this is about the First Amendment, freedom of speech, political association, but the primary protections against political policing are located in the Fourth Amendment. As Benjamin pointed out earlier, this is the center of the Hanshew Agreement, was that the spying, surveillance, infiltration, disruption is a violation of the Fourth Amendment protection against unreasonable search and seizure. And what predictive policing and precision policing does is it undermines Fourth Amendment protections by claiming that social networking, undefined algorithms, etc., constitute either reasonable suspicion, probable cause, or even sufficient evidence to charge criminal conspiracy in the absence of an overt act or physical evidence. So the handshoe rethink is trying to tighten up and say, no, we can't have this demographics unit that just surveils everyone. We've got to tighten it up. But at the same time, what we see is an undermining of Fourth Amendment protections that could be the basis for such a tightening up. And of course, at the federal level, the protections are very thin. Now, this is a federal case, so it could have implications if it's appealed and it moves up, etc. But it's not clear that that will happen. But these kinds of conspiracy investigations almost always rely on local cooperation. And that's important because that's where we have leverage. If we want to talk about strategy, our chances of convincing the Justice Department to dial back political policing under the Trump administration seem very thin. If we look at the executive orders that have been issued already, if we look at the kinds of appointments that are being made, these are old-fashioned political policing proponents. They are going to expand surveillance. If you look closely at some of the executive orders, you see a lot of provisions about quarterly reporting. Now, right now, it seems pretty innocuous, quarterly reporting about victims of crimes committed by illegal aliens, or quarterly reports about crimes committed by transnational crime organizations, you know, gangs. But this is giving them, building up an intelligence infrastructure to produce these quarterly reports and creating a kind of momentum around we need more reporting, more surveillance, etc. And of course, the orders to do this kind of political policing are not going to appear in a public executive order. So we don't know what's already happening behind the scenes. And of course, we can't count on Congress to be any kind of meaningful check given its current composition. The NYPD, however, says that they don't want to do the demographics unit, even though they obviously were continuing to engage in surveillance here at Brooklyn College, even after they claimed that they had quit doing this. First, they claimed it didn't exist. Then they claimed they weren't doing it anymore. And then we continued to get concrete proof that they were still doing it, maybe under a different name or whatever. We have to go after these efforts to rely on technology in the absence of concrete evidence, and we have to go after any NYPD cooperation with federal law enforcement at any level, and we have to point out that this is just like the Red Scares, this is just like the Palmer Raids, this is a continuation of politically driven policing that is not about actually solving any real problems, because those past political policing initiatives are not about solving problems. They're about managing disparate populations who tend to be non-white, poor, and politically questioning of what's going on. And so we need to direct our energies both at making sure that CUNY is working with us, not against us, and they have been a very poor partner in this effort, absolutely. Mustafa and I were both involved in passing resolutions at faculty council, calling on the president and the chancellor to make statements. Those efforts were very minimal, and maybe there were some behind-the-scenes conversations that we don't know about, but there should have been op-eds in the major newspapers, there should have been press conferences, there should have been outrage, and instead there was a lot of empty hand-wringing. And so we do need a more robust response from CUNY administration, but we also need social movements that are emerging now to understand that political policing threatens them, threatens immigrants, threatens all these constituencies that Trump has in the crosshairs. Thank you. Could I stay and see if there are questions for me? Hello. Absolutely.
Right? And then what do you think will happen?
You know, some provisions were pulled back because there were sunset clauses when it was passed, the Patriot Act. But I think that you have a federal government now that's going to embrace those tools robustly. Just as an analogous example, the re-enlivening of the 287G agreements. These are agreements by which local law enforcement agree to act as immigration enforcement agents. And so this had really been discredited. Local police departments were under a lot of pressure politically not to do it because it was seen as both undermining their effectiveness in these communities and as a distraction from what they were doing, and immigrant communities exerted political pressure to stop it. Now it's being brought back, despite the fact that we know it's counterproductive, because it's not about that. It's about a set of political priorities and a kind of signaling of political priorities by the Trump administration. And I think we'll see that with the Patriot Act. I can guarantee you there are people in Sessions' office at Justice who are scouring through it once again, trying to figure out what tools are in there that they could use for these political purposes. And so the trick is we've got to stay on top of it. We've got to expose those abuses, and we've got to build for the long haul. We've got to build for 2 years, 4 years, thinking about when the political calculation shifts and we have certain kinds of openings. I don't think court strategies are going to be particularly successful, so that we cannot count on the civil liberties lawyers to bail us out on these things, because as the federal courts are being remade, they're going to be a less fruitful avenue for addressing this.
You know, I remember with the Patriot Act too, that if I remember correctly, there was a time early on when they wanted librarians to report.
Yeah, and not only that, booksellers.
And booksellers, so, that's right.
They would go into the record.
Exactly. But there was a mutiny on the part of the librarians and the booksellers that they were not going to do this. And they scaled back on that. I mean, now we find out that the NSA has been spying on everybody all the time anyways. But I think that that's really important, because it was a kind of, you know, a social movement. Yeah. It was the guilds, it was the organizations, it was the people's own, like, you know, identities were engaged in the fight back against that. So.
And similarly with the telecommunications companies and the internet companies, you know, we have to keep the pressure on Facebook and Twitter and Google for the kind of data that they're sharing without warrants for phishing expeditions. And these fishing expeditions are going to be political in nature. They're not going to be about making us safe. Joseph?
Do we know that there's currently no surveillance by NYPD on our campus?
No, we don't know that. Definitely we don't know that.
Is that something that one could know definitively?
Well, this is the thing about political policing. It is hard to know. So we had a question before about, well, what? How do I know if there's a plainclothes undercover or informant working with me? It's very hard to know. That's a third category, right? There's undercover, which is assuming a false identity. Then there's plainclothes. I'm a police officer. I'm just not wearing a uniform. I might be walking in the demonstration with other people, but if pressed, I would show my ID and say, yes, I'm a police officer. And then an informant who is working for the police department without making that publicly known. So we don't know if any of these three categories
of folks are operating on campus. It's clear that the NYPD does not feel like it has to abide by whatever CUNY has said in terms of what it wants, and we don't know on what basis that would be occurring. They claim that if they do have credible, concrete evidence of something, they'll pursue it wherever it takes them. So they don't care what CUNY says. But are they also just engaged in raking and crawling and these other kinds of tactics that aren't based on any kind of reasonable suspicion, much less probable cause? How would we find out? It's very difficult. It's very difficult. The advice I've given to students, including some of the students around, is that we have to look at the behavior rather than trying to establish the identity. Problematic behavior is problematic behavior, whether it's being committed by a registered student, someone with a mental health problem, an undercover informant, an infiltrator, etc. Target the behavior. If someone is coming into your group and saying things that don't make sense, that seem really problematic, you've got to call them out on it. And if the problem persists, then you don't want them in your group. Doesn't matter whether or not they're a police officer. You don't want that because they're not in tune with the values of your organization. And you've got to ask for help. And that means reaching out to faculty you trust, the CUNY Clear Project, etc. Don't worry that because you ask for help that somehow there's going to be floodlights and an investigation and finger. No, we can talk to people about how to think sensibly about these things, how to take precautions. So I encourage people to reach out, not to let it fester inside the organization that then makes the organization dysfunctional. Yep.
So about the first two kinds of undercover people, NYPD that are on campus, legally, if you ask them, are you a police officer? If they are, they have to say they are, and if they're not.
No, that's not true. If they're operating undercover, now the Hanshu Agreement says that they can only be doing that if they've met certain criteria. What's clear is that that was not the case. They were operating in violation of even the watered down agreement. From what's been described in the media, it seems pretty clear. They do not have to admit that they're a police officer. And in practice, even a plainclothes officer will often not comply with the regulations to identify themselves.
Oh, I know that the police feel like they're above the law. I mean, so in terms of protecting yourself, it's just about how well you could read somebody's body language and how they talk around you. And what kind of questions would be considered suspicious.
These are times that demand a certain amount of bravery also, and that people have got to sort of stick to their principles. And that means that we cannot retreat into the shadows because someone might be watching. Because what we know is that they're always potentially watching in ways that we understand and don't understand, and that we need to embrace our beliefs and our actions, and we've just got to marshal forward, and we've got to call out people who are doing stupid things. And they're stupid mostly because they don't work. Right? In the American context, we have a pretty good idea that the use of extra legal violence, etc., is really counterproductive. And anyone who's proposing that as a strategy is not giving you a useful strategy. And they should be called out on that basis alone, if not others. And anyone who says that they've got this great plan that's going to bring us to the next level by doing something really stupid is not your friend and is not really working for what you're working for. And I think if you keep that attitude in mind and you make clear what you do stand for, then it makes it harder to be caught up in some of this. Doesn't mean the surveillance won't happen. It means that there's less to worry about in terms of the implications. And so I know it's very easy to stand here and say we have to be brave, but the harms that you mentioned are real harms, but there are also things we can do to mitigate against those harms, and that's producing a culture of activism that is resilient against those threats. You know, during the civil rights movement, what the FBI would do is they'd go to meetings, they'd go out into the parking lot, and not surreptitiously take pictures of the license plates, but very openly and grandiosely with big flashes and stuff. Why? Not because they were going to do anything with the license plate numbers, because they wanted to intimidate people, to constantly feel they were being watched. And the civil rights movement understood that and took steps to buoy people's bravery. Yes, but we're all in this together. We're not doing anything illegal. We're on it. We're here for a just reason, and we've got to just marshal forward.
Thank you.
Yeah.
As our last speaker for today, I'll introduce Sandra Kingan, our organizer from the Department of Mathematics. Her expertise is in combinatorics, theoretical, and its theoretical applications to network science.
Thank you. Has he gone to sleep?
Do you need me to stand by the computer in advance? Slides or anything?
No, I'm good. I can.
We totally shut down.
Yes, I have totally shut down. Yes. Okay.
This is firing back up too.
So my talk is like a typical maths talk. I have slides. And thank you all for waiting. So there are some people in the audience, and of course, you know, the rest of the audience who will watch this on Facebook in the future. So I'm going to be talking about the mathematics and covert networks, and hopefully it will give some understanding of why this is happening in Brooklyn College. Where does the mathematics come in? The bulk of this talk is on math, but there is not math in the kind that you won't understand. It's really explained in a very broad way, so you don't have to feel like, you know, you have to pull out a notebook and start writing things down. And the third thing is what everyone has been addressing is, okay, we have a problem, now what? And that's really what this whole conference is about. So just 3 weeks ago, this paper came out in Science, and it's titled Challenges in Researching Terrorism from the Field. And it's making some excellent points that, you know, these are the points that I was thinking about, and having this paper made it very easy to get the bullets over here. And what they're saying is the government's national security structure was built to manage state-to-state interaction, not groups that recruit members through diffuse networks, not the kind of terrorist groups that are around now. It relies on all the big organizations to gather information, and it's not complete, not accurate, and there's little research to support generalizations. We are actually maybe falling victims to generalizations, and there's no mathematics to support it. The government's approach to monitoring and capturing terrorists is the same as their approach to criminals. Use of undercover agents, eavesdropping, sting operations. And what the paper says and argues is to treat the spread of violent extremism as a public health issue. Model the spread of radical ideas in a social network like the spread of pathogens in a population, and come up with some different strategies for addressing this issue. All the slides will be available on my webpage, and all the links are there to read up on it further. So let me talk a little bit about social network analysis. My area is graph theory and macro theory, and this is an application of my area, so I don't work directly in it. I prove theorems, but this is an application. A graph is a set of points. The points are called vertices or nodes, joined by lines called edges or links. Network is another word for graph. And here you have a nice little graph. It's not too big. You can actually look at a vertex. This is called a vertex. And you can see the number of edges that meet it. And the degree of this vertex is 4 over here. So social network analysis, straight from Wikipedia, is the process of investigating social structures through the use of graph theory. And I have 4 examples. The first one is an old one. It's from 2004. It's a blogs network. The vertices are blogs, and the edges are the links, and the blogs draw the blogs. You can see that the red is Republican, blue is Democrat, and you can see how most of the people stay within their political arenas, and you can see the echo chambers right there. It's not limited to social sciences. It's really, any area. This is in a protein network. The vertices are proteins, and edges are the physical interactions between proteins. There's a lot of work in biology going on here. The connectome, the vertices are neurons, and edges are links between neurons. That's C. elegans. It's a little nematode whose entire connectome has been determined. It's right there. Graph theory is an old field, 1736. Euler was the first person who wrote the paper, a paper on graph theory. But in the 30s, it came to the attention of the social psychologists. And this was in the New York Times, 1933. And Jacob Marino gave a talk to the Medical Society. And he made a very far-reaching statement over here, which I'll give you a chance to read. And think about Facebook and everything that we have now. And that was in 1933. So I'm going to jump to 1960s, almost 70s, Milgram's famous experiment on Small World, where he showed that we're quite closely connected. It is easy to get from one person to another with at most 6 steps. And that led to Kevin Bacon's game of 6 degrees of separation. And Milgram is better known for his obedience to authority experiment, which I think is required learning for everybody who has to get IRB approval. And I wanted to mention Milgram's experiment in a little bit more detail is because I think it's still relevant to us. We have authority figures employing a vast number or small number, we don't know, of undercover operatives. And who's monitoring the undercover operatives? And what Milgram's experiment shows is that, that kind of unchecked power can bring out the worst in the little guys, not just the big guys. So let's come to centrality measures. Centrality measures are measures for determining which vertices are more important than other vertices. And I will talk about networks in the abstract. The networks can be about anything. You can think social network, so the vertices could be people. One simple way of determining who is more important is just by who knows the most number of people. But that's not the only way. There are other ways. And the other ways and the details are not so important for this talk, suffice to know that there's a lot of mathematics behind it, and Google's PageRank, the algorithm that made Google so famous, I gave a talk on it in the Mathematical Sciences Colloquium yesterday, it was all on Google PageRank, is also a centrality measure. You have the web, the pages are linked to other pages, how to determine which page is important, that was in 1998, Facebook was 2004. And now let's come to covert networks. Networks as vertices and edges have one or more many elements of secrecy about them. The data is incomplete, boundaries are fuzzy, network is not stagnant, it keeps changing. Criminal networks, but also networks like the Underground Railroad, it's a historical network over there, that wasn't a bad thing. So it's not all covert networks are bad, and in some sense, the people who are surveilling us and other people are doing so because they think that there are some covert networks here, maybe, and they themselves are a covert network. All the undercover agents and everything, they form a covert network too. They are multi-layer networks. The people are linked in different manner. Your Facebook network, you've got many layers of interaction there, same with criminal networks. And same in epidemiology, multiple pathogens coexist within the same host population interacting in different manner. So this is not limited to just people. So in 2001, a social network analyst put together apparently a social network of the 9/11 hijackers from publicly available information, put it up and determined the ringleader through centrality measures. And this is, after this, it became something of a, it became more popular. I think before that it was not necessarily so well known. The power of this mathematical technique became obvious. And now I want to jump into a case study that's freely available on the web. It was in fact collected from unclassified sources and quoted by students in a particular college. So this is something actually that we can all do with our students if we want to do some undergraduate projects. And this person's network, he and his network was responsible for several bombings in various places. So he is what the United States would call a terrorist. And his network consists of communication layers, logistics layers, and several other layers. The number in brackets is how connected the network is. And the formulas for getting this are solid. And it's not important for this talk. Suffice to say that the one that is most connected up is the communications layer. All the links for this information are available right here, and this is all publicly available information. So his network was small enough, and you could, just by looking at it, determine which one was maybe most influential. Most networks are not small, and you can't really tell just by looking at it. And the trust network, this was formed, the friendship layer, kinship layer. What that means is, you break up the trust network into the different ways that people were connected. Friendship, kinship, religious layer, the school layer, that's relevant to us. And the number in the brackets, again, is a measure of how centralized the networks were, and you can see over there the school layer was more central. And what this study recommends, and what they call a kinetic strategy, is a euphemism for eliminating the central nodes. And what they say is that that's not a good approach because it only makes the network stronger. So they recommend non-kinetic strategies, diplomacy, institution building, psychological strategies, of which we appear to be facing quite a bit, information gathering, inserting misinformation. So what the study is recommending is don't eliminate people, observe them. It makes a lot of sense if you think about it, but there's a problem here. So in any case, this is the school ties appear to be the strongest network in the strongest layer of the trust network. And therefore, they went ahead and studied the school network in more detail and found that three religious schools were central in the regional school network. Again, this is small enough, you don't need software to determine. You can look at it, no fancy technique needed. You can just look at it and say, yeah, it does look like three religious schools here seem to be harboring a lot of problems. And this is these are the schools over here. And there's a reason why I'm not actually mentioning any names. I don't want to, and even in my book, I try not to mention the names of terrorists and people who have done bad stuff. I do not want to give them that privilege. So I won't mention, that's why I've not been mentioning names. So where do we go from here? Well, in this one study that's completely publicly available, and I imagine there are many more that aren't available, the authors are proposing information gathering as an alternative to the kinetic approach. It seems to make sense. It has the weight of mathematics behind it. But it's clearly a problem for us over here to be a school where there are undercover operatives gathering information about us. We need to figure out why it doesn't make sense here. We need to craft a message and deliver it consistently from all levels, which is something that has been addressed by everyone here, is all of us need to be saying the same thing, and we have to say something more than it is harmful. It's almost abusive. It's stalking. It's criminal activity if you think about it. If you take a step back and think about it, the people observing us and sort of messing with us are stalking us, and that's another type of criminal activity, you could argue. But we need to convey what we have to convey in a way that doesn't make us sound as if we are complaining, nor do we want to sound like victims. Another issue that hasn't come up so far, and I want to emphasize, is if our own government is observing us and thinking there's all this stuff going on here, can you imagine what other governments might do? Where, you could have agents from every other part of the country, China, Russia, name your place, thinking Brooklyn College seems to be the happening place. Let's come here and observe people. And they are not subject to any laws of this country to some extent. And that I think is as big a problem as the NYPD surveilling us. And there is no one authority figure. We can try and address it to that authority figure, but I think it's more of a diffuse problem, and we should treat them like unwanted viruses. In fact, the same techniques that are used to address those biological networks might actually work here. And at the this is the end of my talk now. At the end of the day, the very next thing I would like to do is to treat the people observing us as if they were littering in Brooklyn College. Littering was a problem in this country, and it still is a problem in the rest of the world, and it was made totally uncool through a very effective public health strategy, smoking too, for that matter. We need to treat what they're doing to us as in that context. They're littering on our property and we don't want them here. And I'm going to start off by designing some posters, and hopefully the college will give me permission to put it around, as in, it won't say don't litter, but it will be something like that. Thank you. With that, I think we end.
Well, it'll give people an opportunity to
ask. Oh, yes. Questions, yeah.
So there's a clear connection between what Alex is saying and what you're saying.
Yeah.
But Alex is, from what I understand, Alex's presentation is saying that, you know, how can you judge when there's like an actual connection in the network that is, you know,
meaningful,
as opposed to just a random connection, right? I mean, there are all kinds of ways in which, you know, in which people are connected that are meaningless, and there are ways that are meaningful, depending on what that your map is supposed to show.
Yeah, and the first paper that I mentioned actually addresses that, as in there's too much generalization. Mm-hmm. What works in one area doesn't necessarily work in another, and then there's this random connections. More research has to be done that will, the algorithms could be made better.
Because I'm sorry.
Wait, no, please.
Oh, I mean, I think, I think that the ways that the policing here happens too, it's related also to what they think of as organized crime networks as well, right? So anybody who has any connection, organized crime networks were like families, and so anybody who was part of that family, and they would like make these big charts and all of that. And I remember years ago, so I think it's related to what you're describing. Mm-hmm. And I remember years ago, I went to, there was a meeting between the FBI and community leaders, a sort of closed door meeting. And one of the FBI agents there explicitly said, "We're investigating the Muslim community like we investigated the Cosa Nostra." And so it's the same thing. But those are meaningless ties in the long run, are they?
Yes. And in fact, the very first that paper it just was out 3 weeks ago.
Uh-huh.
That is what they're suggesting, that this is not the way to. So someone, the student here who was concerned about, there are bad people, and the silent majority is the silent majority. And what this paper is saying is the techniques that have been used to find bad people in the past are not going to work here. The methods used are not effective. So we have to, from the other side, from the policing side, we have to come up with methods that are effective to tackle the problem at hand. And we can't just say that what worked before we will use, and the government does that a lot. It worked in one situation, so we'll do it in another. This was effective in Indonesia, so we'll try it out here. That's not going to work. I hope the paper also argues for more research in this area to figure out how to handle it. So for the student who wasn't here, yes, the silent majority should not be silent. But at the same time, we shouldn't do destructive things that don't help and only cause more problems. And what is happening at Brooklyn College, the undercover agents, is destructive. It's eroding trust between students, between faculty and students. It's preventing students from learning and faculty from doing their jobs.
This reliance on technology is so quintessentially American, in that it looks for a technocratic fix to what's really a political problem. Why are there some people who are resorting to violence as a political strategy? And at the same token, with like the gang work that I'm doing, why is it that young people are turning to violence as a way of managing their social problems? This gets totally erased by these technocratic discussions of network theory and who knows, you know, this is a way of erasing the political. And so even if the algorithms can be made to work more effectively, that still says that the solution is that we identify people through these technological means and then we suppress them through, you know, these coercive and repressive interventions rather than look at the underlying forces that are motivating behavior.
I mean, one of the things that I find fascinating about this discussion is all of us coming at this problem from disciplinary angles, right? It shows you that on the one hand, here's how we analyze the technical structures by which this is done, but then also the reminder that there are core values like freedom, justice. Trust, justice, camaraderie, the search for truth, right? That ought to be able to kind of like supersede these technical fixes and kind of remind us who we are. And so I think that's really, I think that's really nice about bringing these different perspectives together.
And one of the things recommended for mathematicians and computer scientists is an ethics course, so that we are able to communicate and understand the work that we're doing and its limitations. That's very, very important. There's a small but growing number of mathematicians speaking out about this and saying, you know, don't use, mathematics has its limits. And, you know, when you propose a strategy based on mathematics, it carries weight. So you have to be careful what exactly you're proposing and make the limitations very, very clear.
Great. Thank you, everybody.